Friday today. It's a beautiful day, and looks like all of you made it through the traffic. I know it's pretty crazy out there today, from what I've heard, but you came a long way, and you made it here, Sissy. So good to see you.
Thank you, sir.
Today we have the joy of commissioning our Bethlehem missionaries to South Africa. They're going to be next Sunday at this time. So we commissioned them today, and that is Valerie Groon and Susan Heinbach and Jessica Harrison. We'll be including them in the prayers of the church today as well. And just a reminder that if you did take an envelope, in fact, thank you everybody for taking one because they all disappeared in a good way. That if you took one and put the $7 in that envelope to cover the school supplies for the children, those need to be in today. Also, there's an LWML luncheon after the 11 o'clock service, right after this service today, and all the ladies of the church are invited to join them, the Lutheran Women's Missionary League, for a salad, and a planning meeting for 2017. I'm going to talk about this a little bit more during the sermon today, but if you get a chance, in fact, just do it. Take a look at the information sheet and the bulletin, all the things that are going on at Bethlehem, but take a special look at all the Bible studies that we have in the small groups. So I think there's virtually a Bible study or a small group that meets together every day of the week. So please look at that and become involved in one. Be fed by the word and nourished and strengthened and grow.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So as a reminder of the congregation again, on February 25th, we'll be having another movie night. We had one all the way back just before Thanksgiving, and it was a really wonderful event. There was about 30, 40 people there, and a lot of kids, and we hold it right over here across the street in the cottage yard, so the kids can kind of run around, and it's all enclosed by a fence, and it's very safe. The movie will be kid and family friendly, so please feel free to invite any friends or neighbors or anyone you know, or just come yourself. There will be free food, hamburgers, hot dogs, drinks, and in the back of the church we have a sign-up sheet. If you are so disposed, please consider also helping. There's a lot of need for setup and breakdown as well, but if you can't, please just come and enjoy the event. Thank you, and that's on February 25th once again, and that's 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. That's a Saturday.
We're so blessed today to have the bells playing. I'd like just to take this time, remain seated, and as you listen to this beautiful music, the bells, let it prepare your hearts for worship.
Thank you. the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. We would kneel for our confession. When the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us. Not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy. Let us go to him confident that he will grant us forgiveness for Jesus' sake. We take a moment of silence for reflection on God's word and for self-examination. Heavenly Father,
we confess that we are by nature sinful. We have failed to exhibit goodness, the fruit of your Spirit, in our thinking, speaking, and acting. We have not always chosen life, loving the Lord our God, obeyed his voice, and held fast to him. We have not always sought to be reconciled to our brothers. Our Lord Jesus revealed his person and ministry through his words and actions. Your great mercy, forgive, renew, and lead us, so that we may be revealed as his faith-filled followers to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We stand and sing.
But if your heart turns away and you are not obedient,
And if you are drawn away to bow down to other gods and worship them, I declare to you this day that you will certainly be destroyed. You will not live long the land you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. This day I call heaven and earth as witnesses against you that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Now choose life, so that you and your children may live and that you may love the Lord your God. Listen to his voice and hold fast to him. For the Lord is your life, and he will give you many years in the land he swore to give to your fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson comes from the book of 1 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter. Brothers, I could not address you as spiritual but as worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. For since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere men? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not mere men? What, after all, is Apollos? And what is Paul? Only servants, through whom you came to believe, as the Lord has assigned to each his task. I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God made it grow. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. The man who plants and the man who waters have one purpose, and each will be rewarded according to his own labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
You have heard that it was said to the people long ago, do not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you that anyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to his brother, Raca, is answerable to the Sanhedrin. But anyone who says, you fool, will be in danger of the fire of hell. Therefore, if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First go and be reconciled to your brother. Then come and offer your gift. Settle matters quickly with your adversary who is taking you to court. Do it while you are still with him on the way. Or he may hand you over to the judge, and the judge may hand you over to the officer, and you may be thrown into prison. I tell you the truth, you will not get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that it was said, do not commit adultery. But I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to go into hell. It has been said, anyone who divorces his wife must give her a certificate of divorce. But I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except for marital unfaithfulness, causes her to become an adulteress. And anyone who marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to the people long ago, do not break your oath, but keep the oaths you have made to the Lord. But I tell you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is God's throne, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make even one hair white or black. Simply let your yes be yes, and your no, no. Anything beyond this comes from the evil one. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Let us join together in confessing our common faith in the Lord. words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please be seated.
Church.
Now he's been away for 2 or 3 years, and he's writing them this epistle. And during the time that he was away, and really one of the reasons that he is writing today, is because during those 2 or 3 years of absence while he was away, other missionaries, other pastors came and visited. Apollos came and visited, and Peter also came and visited. You can read a little bit about Peter in the first chapter, where he's asked the same question. He says, some of you are following me, and others are following Apollos, and others are following Peter. In fact, Paul even mentions that again today, and actually it's a text for next week, but it's the end of chapter 3. He says, all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas, who is Peter, or the world, or life, or death, or the present, or the future, all are yours. And you are of Christ, and Christ is of God. And so he's writing this letter. It's an epistle, because he's writing to a congregation. He writes a letter to an individual, like to Timothy, when he writes that letter. But when he writes an epistle, it is intended to be read to the whole congregation, because the whole congregation needs to hear what Paul had to say. And God wanted the church of all time to hear what he had to say as well. This wasn't something that was just written in its own historical context for that particular day or that particular event. But in God's divine wisdom, he wanted this letter, this epistle, to be read, to continue to be read to the churches of all time. And so he comes and speaks to us again today. And so Paul continues his epistle by telling the congregation that he has some harsh words for them. In fact, he tells them that they are worldly. Can you imagine this church that he had started, and now he's been away from them, and one of the first things that he tells them is that they are worldly. And he tells them that they are acting like little babies. That they are acting not just as children. In fact, the Greek word that Paul uses here is nepios, not the word for child, which is technon. He calls them nepios, which means little babies. He says, you are acting like little babies. It's not like, oh, they're just children. Kids will be kids. Teenagers will be children. No. Paul takes it down to its smallest component here. You're acting like babies. And he's telling the whole congregation this. Now, it doesn't mean that everybody in the congregation is involved in it, but certainly these different factions that are in the church are affecting the whole congregation with the way that they are acting. And basically what you have is you have the church, like right here, this part is divided. This is the church that says, we follow Paul. And this section right down the middle, we say, no, we follow Apollos. And this section over here, no, we follow Peter. Kind of modern day language, it's like following a football team. You know, we're passionate about that. We're passionate about this person. We belong to that person. And Paul says, no, you don't. You don't follow me. Who am I? You don't follow Apollos. Who is he? You don't follow Peter. Who is he? We all belong to Christ. I belong to Christ. Apollos belongs to Christ. Peter belongs to Christ. You belong to Christ. Everything that we have belongs to Christ. And everything that Christ has belongs to us. It's all in Christ, and all we are, all I am is an apostle, Paul. I'm just a servant. Apollos is a servant. Peter is a servant. And he brought me into this place called Corinth to plant the seed of the gospel. Without that seed of the gospel, you wouldn't even be here. He just used me as a servant, just as an instrument to plant the seed, but it's not me. I have no power in it at all. God himself created the growth. The Holy Spirit created the growth. And then he sent along Apollos. And Apollos had the joy of being a servant to water that seed. See, he doesn't care who's watering it. All that counts is that it's watered. And so Apollos had that joy. And then Peter came along and he continued to build on what Apollos watered and what I planted. But you know what? It doesn't have anything to do with us. it's that automatic growth of the seed. It's the power of the gospel, that seed that has been planted among you. And you take away the seed, there is no church. We are just called to be servants. And he's kind of like saying, you know what, I thought you knew this. It's hard to believe that I've been away for 2 years and you're acting the same way that you acted when I first came. You're acting worldly. You're acting like little babies. What is this business of Christ's church being divided anyway? What is this quarreling among you? What is it that some of you are saying you are following me, you're following Paulus, or following Peter? We are just servants. And then he says, not only does the seed belong to Christ, not only does the Holy Spirit create the growth, but guess what? The whole field belongs to me. Not just you. It's not just a relationship between me and you. Yes, that's a profound relationship, but it's not just me and you. It is the whole church, because the whole field belongs to me. Each one of you belongs to me. And not only that, he takes it a step farther and he says, and in fact, the whole building belongs to me. Paul is mixing metaphors all over the place here. He's talking about the field belonging to me and the building belonging to him. And then he, in the next chapter here, next section, he goes into the whole body belongs to me. You are the body of Christ and each one of you is a part of it. What an incredible thing, but it's a reminder that it all belongs to God, and we all belong to God. He owns the field, and he creates the growth. He is the church's one foundation, and he's the capstone. And if you take away the foundation, the church collapses. And if you take away the capstone, the church collapses. It all comes crumbling down. He is the foundation. He is the capstone. He's the beginning. He's the end. He's the Alpha. He's the Omega. He says, I'm just a servant, and I have the joy of serving the Lord this way, because we all belong to Christ. I'd like to share with you a few illustrations of what Paul was talking about. And the first illustration is regarding spiritual and physical babies. Now, Paul has never been a father. He's probably never changed a diaper in his life. He's never had a baby, but he's had lots of spiritual babies through the preaching of the gospel. And spiritual babies are a lot like physical babies. A baby has no teeth. They can only swallow. They cannot chew. They can only take in liquids, not solids. They have to be given a little, but often. And that's kind of the way this church was acting. Paul says, it's time for you to grow up. Been 2 years since I started this church, since I planted the seed, and it's time for you to grow up. He's reminding them of an ancient prayer that we, even in this church, pray often, that we need to read and mark and learn and inwardly digest God's word so that it can grow up within us. And we can't just... Paul isn't telling them that they're not Christians. He's not telling them that they're not believers. In fact, what he's telling them is just the opposite. He said, you are Christians, you are believers, so why are you acting this way? And if you want to live on a diet of milk and liquid for the rest of your life, you can. You can. You know, you're still a part of my field. But is that really where you want to spend the rest of your life? Just on a liquid diet? Do you want to grow? Do you want to be strong? Do you want to be nurtured by the word? Do you want something to chew on? Do you want something to inwardly digest? So that you can grow up and be the servants that I would have you be. And in fact, Bethlehem, I want to tell you, church, that God would have all of us be in the word. We have opportunities to gather together in Bible studies and in small groups every single day of the week here. We don't have a Bible study here at 8 o'clock or 11 o'clock. We have two of them at 9:30, one over in Disciples Hall and the other over in the cottage. But maybe somebody needs to start at 11 o'clock Bible study. Go for it. Be in the Word. Take advantage of the opportunities that you have to grow and to chew on solid food. And I know that we have people that drive here all the way from St. John's County, and we have people that drive here, believe it or not, from Fernandina Beach and the west end of Orange Park. People that drive an hour and 15 minutes, and it's difficult for them to come to a Bible study during the week or a small group. Start a Bible study in your home. Can you imagine what that would be like as a seed is planted there, and as maybe you invite a neighbor or a family member, and the next thing you know, you have three or four people, and it continues to grow. Be in the Word. And if you can't be involved in a Bible study or a small group, I want to encourage you, brothers and sisters in Christ, to be in the Word on a personal basis. Do you know that you can read through the Bible in a year if you only read 3 chapters a day and 5 on Sunday? Now, maybe that's a lot. Maybe you don't like to read that way and you want to take time to inwardly digest it. Well, extend it out and read 1 chapter a day and 3 on Sunday, and take 3 years to read through the Bible. And I'm at a point in my life where I don't like to read large sections at a time. I like to read small, shorter verses, paragraphs at a time, and reflect on that, because it's so profound to read through the Psalms. But whatever you do, be in the Word every single day so that you can inwardly digest this Word that gives us life. And as it gives us life, we can be moved to be servants of Christ. And the second illustration is that children can fight. Children can fight. I once visited a home where children were fighting. There was a boy and a girl in the house, and they were fighting, and he had her hair and had pulled her to the ground, and she was on top of him, and she was slapping him in his face, and the mother was horrified. The pastor comes to visit, the children are fighting. He was 3. She was 2. And you know what? That was what was happening in the church in Corinth. It was all about jealousy. In fact, the mother said, "Pastor, I'm so sorry. I'm so embarrassed. Ever since she was born, he's been so jealous." And that's the word that Paul uses in verse 3, chapter 3, verse 3. He says there are jealousies among you, and that's what's causing the divisions. And there can be jealousies in the church today. Usually in the church, and thank you, Lord, there are very, very few. I've never experienced it in my ministry where there are physical altercations, but there can be verbal altercations. And I'll tell you what, sometimes those verbal altercations can be pretty nasty. Some people know how to fight with words, and evidently that's what was taking place in this church in Corinth. It was divided into factions, Paul and Peter and Apollos. Paul says God would have none of that. When you act that way, you are acting like little babies, and it's time to grow up. And you can maybe understand a little bit how all of this begins. Paul had started the church. He had first planted the seed of the gospel, and the people were affectionate towards that. Paul doesn't criticize the affections that you have for one another or your leaders or your pastors. But when jealousies are created and we say, "I follow this person," Paul says, God would have none of that. You are not acting like the spiritual people that God would have you be. There was a huge allegiance to Paul for that reason. And then Apollos came along. And by the way, there was no division between Paul and Apollos and Peter. The problem wasn't between them. In fact, Paul honors him today by saying, "Yeah, Apollos, he won her. This is what a wonderful thing that we got to share in this ministry together." But the people saw Apollos differently. Apollos was like, when you read about Apollos, he was a great preacher. Paul last week said that he himself, as Paul, didn't come with eloquence of speech. I would probably take issue with that. I think there was a little bit of just Paul being modest there, because when you read some of his prose and poetry, it is wonderful. But he says, I didn't come with eloquence, but Apollos. This is a guy, I mean, this is like the TV evangelist, where he's got this robe and it is perfectly ironed, and he's got the latest brand of sandals, and every hair is in place, and all of his teeth are straight and really white. And not only that, he is eloquent, and he's full of passion. He can really whip the people into shape, really get them going. And so we follow Paul. Yeah, Paul, he planted, but Apollos, he's the one that is really taking our church to the next level. So people are following him. And Peter, there's this huge allegiance to Peter. Peter was a great preacher too. Just read his sermon in the second chapter of Acts, where he's preaching in Jerusalem to the very ones who had crucified Christ. You want to talk about a sermon? The people felt drawn, this allegiance to Peter, because Peter had actually literally walked with Jesus. Peter was the one who could preach a sermon and tell them what it was like when Jesus was walking on water and he called them to get out of the boat. And Peter could tell them what it was like for him actually to walk on water for a few steps, as long as he was focused, fixing his eyes on Jesus. But the moment he took them off, his eyes off of Jesus, he began to sink. And even when he was going down, Jesus lifted him up, rescued him, saved him, and loved him. He was the one who could talk about how he had denied the Savior, and yet Jesus had restored him into a right relationship with him. He's the one that could talk about what it was like at the top of the mountain of Transfiguration, but what it was like to walk in the valleys with Jesus. He's the one that could talk about the twinkle in Jesus' eye when he told a joke. What it was like to hear Jesus laugh. He was one who talked about what it was like to sit at that table when Jesus instituted his holy supper. What it was like to eat breakfast with him on the beach. He's the one that could tell fishing stories and that could really draw in the men of the congregation. And so there's this part of the congregation, this faction, that says, no, we follow Peter. You can see how it happens. But Paul said, that's not what it's about. I'm nothing. Apollos is nothing. Peter is nothing. He just used me to plant, and Apollos to water, and Peter to build. The church is not about us. It is all about Jesus. And Paul then ends this section with those beautiful words of gospel in verse 9. He says, for we are all God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. In other words, all that we have belongs to Christ, and all that Christ has belongs to us. The seed belongs to Christ. The field belongs to Christ. The foundation belongs to Christ. The capstone belongs to Christ. The building belongs to Christ. Everything that we have belongs to Christ. And whatever form ministry takes, whether it's planting or watering or building, there can be no mistake about its nature. The nature of my ministry or Vicar's ministry, or Pastor Jacobs is here, his ministry, your ministry, the gifts God has given to you today, the nature of ministry is servanthood. And it's the kind that is exhibited by the Lord himself, who laid down his life as a ransom for many. That is the field in which we grow. And that, my friends, is the church's one foundation, that we are all servants for Christ's sake. And our only boast is in Christ, in whom and through whom we have all things. May it be so for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Lord God, Heavenly Father, you are a loving, faithful, and truthful God. Raise us as children whom you have called to be your spiritual people, to exhibit the same traits. Curb our anger and help us to be reconciled to our brothers. Shield our eyes from lust, that we may look at others in purity as brothers and sisters whom you have created. Guard our lips from deceit, that we may praise your name, comfort our neighbors, and speak your truth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Lord, you sent Paul and Apollos long ago to plant and water the seed that is your word. By your grace, grow, train, and send pastors and church workers and missionaries to do the same in our day. Plant and bring that seed to fruition around the world. Yet keep us ever mindful that it's you who provides the growth, especially this day as we send several of our missionaries to Africa. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, our King, you rule the nations of the world. Give wisdom to all who rule this land, that they may serve you faithfully and obey your commandments. Help them to promote all that is good and right, and to prevent and punish what is evil. Wherever our courts or laws are unjust and contrary to your will, lead us to reform them, that our ways may be blameless in your sight. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful Lord, look down from heaven. Behold, visit and relieve your servants who are heavy laden with afflictions or griefs of body and mind. Especially we pray for Janet Beatman, June Jamrich, Linda Cox, Jackie Mills, Helen Gerhart, Laureen Arthur, Jeannie Roman, Kimberly Gildersleeve, Zeke and Bev Zelmer, Martha Fisher, and Larry Corbett. Be also, Lord, with those who suffer from mental illnesses, many of whom are homeless. Look upon them in mercy. Call them to the shelter that is your church. Defend them from every danger to body and soul, and comfort them with a sure confidence in you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty Lord, before us always lies life and good, death and evil. Bless us to walk in your ways, that we may be blameless before you, and that we may steadfastly keep your statutes. Do not let our hearts turn to other gods, but keep them fixed on you. Help us to see that in your word and sacraments you have not forsaken us, but that by them you bring us life through your Son, in the power of your Spirit. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, dear Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever, and who has taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is a new testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as ye drink of it in remembrance of me."
blood of our Lord, strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the one true faith, now and until life everlasting. Depart in his peace.
Amen.
Let us return thanks. We give thanks, Heavenly Father, that you have refreshed us through this sacrament, and we pray that, forgiven and changed thereby, we may continue to grow in Christ's holy church. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Receive the Lord's benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. We sing together our final hymn.
Go in peace to love.